And the application we are discussing in this lecture of the weak L2 metric will be an application from shape analysis. And while we had this already a little bit in the introduction, let me give you a bit of a refresher what shape analysis is. And so what are the goals, and then we'll do this rigorously, because we now have all the tools at our disposal to at least understand what theorems are about, even if we don't do all the details in the lecture. Okay, so what is shape analysis? So first of all, what is a shape? And in this context, shapes are unparametrized curves in a vector space or on a manifold, right? So now we have two things here. Okay, curves, we understand. What do we mean by unparametrized? Basically, say for example, in an application, so we have these contours here. So we have can represent objects like these pedestrians by their contours. And so obviously it's not important how the contour is traced out by a curve. So this would be the curve part. So we can think of these contours as closed curves, where we so we can think of them by as a smooth mapping on, let's say, the circle S1 with values here, in this case in R2, because our picture is two-dimensional. And obviously we don't really care how the contour is parametrized. What is more important to us is to understand how what kind of qualitatively different contours we can have. And again, sort of an application might be you have a traffic camera and you want the computer to pick up what is a pedestrian, so what is a human walking there, and what is a car, for example. Might want to teach that to a computer. And so the computer might be tempted to, or you want perhaps to teach the computer, look at the contour, compare it with some sort of library of contours we give you, and then whatever it matches most closely then is with high probability the object you're observing. Okay. However, this was not too much. Another shape we could have are these three-dimensional shapes, or at least the surface in three-dimensional space. So we can do morphing of these surfaces, and we can perhaps look at these also as manipulation of shapes. And so the whole setting, as you would expect from a lecture on infinite dimension geometry, is now an infinite dimension manifold, the so-called shape space. And shape space is morally a regular curve modulo parametrization. And what we want to be using as tools is our equivariant Riemannian metrics. We understand now what a Riemannian metric is, and we want to make them equivariant with respect to the group action of the diffeomorphism group. So thinking of a reparametrization as a diffeomorphism of the domain of the mapping. So when we want to quotient out all of these reparametrization, that basically means quotienting out the action of the diffeomorphism group. So, and for example, if our shapes are smooth functions from S1 with values, let's say, in R2, then we have the diffeomorphism group of S1 acting on the space from the right by the following formula. So we take an F, we take a diffeomorphism, and just do precomposition. And by everything we know about our function spaces, we know that this is a smooth operation. So we have, and if we believe that the diffeomorphism group is a Lie group, we actually have a Lie group action here on this infinite dimensional space on the left. And then we can ask, is the Riemannian metric, for example, the L2 metric invariant? And the L2 metric we have been discussing this morning is obviously not invariant. Because what does that mean? So we would basically say, for example, take the integral of f composed with phi g composed with phi, so that then the group has acted. Let me write d theta here without the details. And if I want to have a change of variables formula for this, then what I see is that if I want to relate this to this guy, the change of variables formula would give me, I don't need to write the norm here, but that would give me, put that now, that would give a there to be that would give me exactly here. So I need to take the derivative of the of the diffeomorphism. And then, so this would be the right formula. So, and we see that this is obviously, or depending on the diffeomorphism, but in general, this won't be the same as the L2 metric applied to these two things. So this is a non-invariant metric, right? And why do we want an equivariant metric with respect to this action? The idea is, so shape space should be a space of regular curves. So here is our space of regular curves. And we want to quotient out the parametrization. And the parametrization is given by the diffeomorphism group. So we actually want to go to a quotient space where we take the manifold in red on the left-hand side and quotient out this group action. And hopefully we get something which resembles, again, an infinite dimensional manifold. And if we have a Riemannian metric on our red space, which is equivariant, then we can then the quotient of this operation. So when we take the C infinity function quotient out the diffeomorphisms, this will inherit a Riemannian manifold structure by just by the usual quotient construction, as you might believe works. So if we have the Riemannian metric, and if it would, I mean, if the left-hand side of our calculation would be equal to the right-hand side for the L2 metric, then what we would get here is something which is impervious to the reparametrization. So every element in the same equivalence class under the group action has the same L2 metric, or the sort of the L2 product of these two things would be the same, and we could just quotient everything out and it would make sense on the quotient space. Right. However, obviously, this is not the case here. So we have to work a little bit harder. And we're coming exactly to this problem, which was already mentioned several times here. So if we take the L2 metric, then Micho and Mumford have proven that if we make the L2 metric equivariant, so we have seen this yesterday in the lecture, way basically by taking the absolute value of the derivative of the diffeomorphism into account and making the change of variables formula work, we can create an equivariant L2 metric on this on the shape space. And what Micho and Mumford have shown is that the geodesic distance for this one vanishes identically. And this is obviously bad because, say, we want to compare these contours of the pedestrians with something else. Then how do you compare it using Riemannian geometry? We would like to compute geodesics. And we have seen that for the L2 metric, it's very simple to compute geodesics, right? So we just have to linearly interpolate between the points on the curves. And then we just need to integrate up over the parameter. We are interpolating this, and this gives us some measure of distance between those two things. So the L2 metric is very, very nice because the geodesics are explicit. We can explicitly compute them. We can explicitly compute the geodesic the length of such a geodesic. However, if we do this for the equivariant L2 metric, on one hand, probably the calculation of the geodesic gets more involved. And then we have the proof that the geodesic distance vanishes. So we cannot use the geodesic, or there's no use of computing that because it's zero anyway. So this will not help us to distinguish the contours between, if we have two different contours, then geodesic distance with respect to the equivariant metric is simply not picking up the differences here. Okay. So this is bad, especially since we put all the work into understanding what this L2 metric is about, right? And fortunately, there is a very nice trick which has had received a lot of attention over the last years in the shape analysis community. And actually, what you can do is you can relate the L2 metric we have constructed to an equivariant metric which is more complicated and for which you can prove that it has vanishing geodesic distance. Actually, this will also be true for the non-invariant L2 metric. But okay, let's see how this works. So let's be a bit more concrete, and I mean we are writing that down later on again. So first of all, let us okay, for my convenience, let's let the unit interval be called I now, and let's consider the pre-shape space. So we are actually not working on all of the smooth mappings. We want to be working on the immersions. Actually, since it's not important how the shapes are oriented, we're working at at immersions which always start at zero, right? So the reason why you want an immersion is basically you don't want your shape to or the parameterization to stop at some point and rest there. You just want to sort of injectively, perhaps not injectively, but at least locally injectively circle around this thing. And I mean, you can of course also instead of you working with immersions, you could be working with embeddings. The difference here is mainly that if you have immersions, you can, for example, allow for shapes which look, say, for example, like a circle of eight thing, right? And then for technical reasons, we are not quotienting out the whole diffeomorphism group, but only the component of the diffeomorphism group for which the derivatives are always positive. So basically, those are the orientation-preserving diffeomorphisms. We don't want that shapes. So take, for example, this circle of eight. This figure, sorry, it's not a circle, it's a figure of eight thing. So if you're running around in this direction, then this should give you something different when compared to, it's the same circle of eight, figure of eight, what's wrong here? When you go in the converse direction. So we should have a positive distance between those two things. We want to distinguish the orientation. Okay.
Alexander,
Yes.
I have been wondering a bit about that part. Is there any specific reason why you want them to be orientation preserving? Because in the in shape analysis, you as the examples you come up with, like you just have it as the contour of an object, then you wouldn't really care about.
That's true. Yes. So actually, I mean, these slides are a little bit. So I borrowed slides from myself, and where I want to be going later on. I mean, this is setting up sort of the stuff. I mean, we will see it on one of the later slides before we stop with the slideshow here. The reason is because at least these slides aim at an application where it's irrelevant which way they are ordered, because I mean, this is all coming out of this work with Elena and Markus Eslitz-Bichler, where in the end what we want to be comparing is or we want to be working with motion capturing data. And at least in this setting with the motion capturing data, sort of reversing the orientation, this would not be bad, but it would mean that sort of the movement which you have in the motion capturing data is running backwards. And while this is in principle not a problem, you don't want to identify the motion forward with the motion backward. Just for this application, wouldn't like to do that. Okay.
Great, thanks.
Yeah, but it's a good question. Yeah, so I mean, in principle, you can of course also quotient out not the diff plus, but the whole diffeomorphism group, which in this case would just mean that you're forgetting about the orientation of these things. Okay, so okay, right. We can then hope to build a reparameterization invariant metric, and this will, in at least in this general shape analysis setting, this will be the geodesic distance induced by our Riemannian metric. This is how we get the distance function on the manifold we care about. Huh? So this is all a Riemannian. Sorry, I should. This is all Riemannian structure. Oops, what's that? Oh. Right. So and then we have the shape space, and now here comes sort of the nice trick, which is due to Anush Srivastava and several other people. At least this appeared at them in the first time in the shape analysis literature, and this is the so-called square root velocity transform, or SRVT. Well, those are just the first letters of the square root velocity transform. And basically, what you do, we have this nice pre-shaped space. So those are the immersions, starting at zero, let's say, from S1 to RD, let's say RD, right? And so what does the square root velocity transform do? So it takes an immersion and takes its derivative, okay? So here we have, I mean, these immersions are smooth, so we end up with a smooth map. And then it's scaling the immersion by the square root of the norm of the velocity. And so basically this looks like a strange thing to do. Let us note two things first. On one hand, this takes us out of the space of immersions. It takes us into the C infinity functions from the interval with values in RD without zero. Why without zero? Because an immersion must have non-vanishing differential. So we cannot have zero here. So zero can never be taken by any map in the image of this R. And this is since we have the compact open topology, we know that this is a nice open subset of the C infinity functions from I with values in RD. And on this space from I with values in RD, actually we will later on, because we have the function space techniques in place only for manifolds without boundary. And what we will be doing is we will not have I here. We will replace this with the circle S1, because there we have our function space techniques all in place. We proved all of this stuff in the lecture. And so we will use S1, but with more work, we had this topic several times already in the lecture. With a little bit more work, you can also make all of these techniques and all of the stuff we have discussed work for function spaces which are defined functions on manifolds with certain kinds of boundary. And especially with the interval we have here, there's not really a big difference, but I refrain from discussing any boundary terms here or something like this. So this is not what we have been doing. So we will always talk about closed shapes, and those are smooth functions from S1 with values in something else. So
Alexander, I didn't, yes? what is this transform? You have curve and you normalize the speed, the yes. velocity vector, you have unit speed curve, or you do not want to reparameterize it, or what?
No, this is not unit speed in general. We're not going into into something like an infinite dimensional sphere. The square. So the if you take the norm of this one, just by the usual yada yada, you get that this is the square root of the velocity. So that's why it's the square root velocity transform, right? And it turns out, we'll see this a little bit later in the lecture. Why you do this transform is the following reason. When you compute it with a change of charts formula, the L2 integrals we have here, the reason why you want here the as the square root is because the square root helps you to see that finish this. So here we have the L2 metric we discussed this morning, right? And we can just restrict if we have a Riemannian metric on, well, actually this is a vector space. We have this Riemannian metric on the vector space, and we have an open subset of a Riemannian manifold, then it automatically becomes also a Riemannian manifold by just restricting the Riemannian metric to the open subset. Mm-hmm. And if we plug in this square root velocity transform into our L2 metric, what we see, when we compute the pullback metric. So what is the pullback metric? So we define a metric G, let me just with respect to this R. So this will now then be a metric on TP, Whitney sum with TP going to the reals. And you define this, so G, C, H, F. So you define this as you take the L2 metric at the point R of C. So you take this transform and then you apply TCR to H and TCR to F. Sorry, no, this is, unfortunately, this is a little bit crappy here. So this is the so-called pullback metric. Of course, you need to check that your mapping R has some nice properties, so that the resulting thing is actually again a Riemannian metric. I mean, if you've ever seen pullback Riemannian metrics, you know how what you have to require. But what you can calculate is that, and this is a little bit the miracle of this square velocity transform. While I mean, it's a very simple transformation, but the idea here is that the resulting metric you get by the pullback metric, on one hand, it has a very explicit form. So perhaps this is going mostly to Irina or other people who have seen the construction again. We'll see the explicit form later. This is a first order Sobolev type metric. If you don't know what that means, just wait for a moment, we'll get there. And it turns out that this first order Sobolev type metric is because of the construction, and this is the magic of the, I mean, it's a bit like praising the square root for no apparent reason, but sort of due to the square root you have in the square root velocity transform, it turns out that the pullback metric is invariant under the reparameterization of with respect to the diffeomorphism group you have there. And this is the reason why you want exactly this transform, because the idea is if you can compute the GUD6 on the space here on the right hand side, so on this space, then these GUD6 correspond to GUD6 on the space with the pullback metric. So by transforming everything with the square root velocity transform, we actually place ourselves in a setting where we can calculate everything using the non-invariant L2 metric. And by the way we have constructed this induces a well-behaved distance function on the shape space, which is the quotient of P modulo the reparametrization action. And this is sort of the whole idea.
Thank you.
Yeah, no, it's a good question. So let's see. This is actually where I wanted to stop with the things. So and this equivariant metric we get is a so-called elastic metric, because sort of, I mean, what is even nicer, the Sobolev type metric you get is basically what is the interpretation? What does this metric compute? So we have now a curve which is somehow lying inside of perhaps I just switched to the other. So let's say we have this closed curve. So elastic metric. I will give you hard definitions and we'll talk more about this a little bit later, but I thought it's nice to see where all of this is leading before we discuss mathematics here. So the elastic metric does the following. So we have now our shapes, which are somehow parameterized curves, right? So we have a concrete curve, let's say a CT, and so perhaps we have another curve, I don't know, something like this. So also we are running out here, and then what this elastic metric is doing, I mean, we are computing closed curves which are sort of intermediate between those. Okay, I'm not trying to do so. Perhaps it looks like this. So and so you basically have to think of this as a time lapse video if you want. So what the geodesics are doing on the infinite dimensional manifold. They are basically transforming the shape CT or this curve C to through intermediate shapes. So the intermediate shape here is CT S. So we have another time parameter, S, and they do this until you reach I don't know, perhaps this point here. You reach sort of the end configuration, which let's call this guy DT here. And what the elastic metric is conceptually doing, I mean, what should you think of what are you computing? What is sort of the distance you're getting? Basically, the concept is you think of this shape as sort of like an infinitely stretchable and deformable band of rubber, which lies in this case here in R2. And so the elastic metric is doing the when you're computing these intermediate shapes, you can think of yourself. So you're taking your rubber band and just rearrange it, and you're moving it around. You're basically stretching it if it needs stretching to go to the new configuration. You're bending it if it bends the wrong way before. And what the elastic metric is measuring, it measures stretching and bending of this operation when you're deforming the shape you start with, the C shape, into the D shape. And that's the idea of this elastic metric. So this is this has a very physical interpretation. It's not just some weird abstract Riemannian metric on an infinite dimensional space you get. But so this is on one hand a well-behaved Riemannian metric. It has a physical interpretation. And this square root velocity transform transforms your elastic metric, which is a Sobolev type metric, so that means it involves derivatives. And this is not totally true, but okay, in first approximation, this is what a Sobolev type metric means. It transforms it to the very simple L2 metric. So after this somewhat longish introduction, what shape analysis wants to be doing. And let's do some mathematical definitions to fix what we have done here. So, so we have 4, 4, 8, where we define the so-called pre-shape space. And this is the P which already occurred there. So we have the immersions from S1 with values in R2. I'm not fixing at the moment the base point. This will destroy a little bit of the nice properties of the SRVT, because then it's not a bijection anymore. But okay, let's ignore this for a moment. The reason why is it not a bijection anymore if I'm not fixing the base point, as you've seen, there is a differentiation process going on, and since we are only having the derivatives, we are forgetting where we have started when we are looking just at the derivatives. So if the C dot of T may not be equal to zero for all T from 0 to 1, sorry, not from 0 to 1, should write theta for all theta in S1. Okay, we know already that P is an open subset of the C infinity functions from S1 with values in R2. And we get a smooth Lie group action let's call this one gamma. And now we can have diff S1. So let's take now the full diff homomorphism group and not just the orientation preserving, because we are not after a specific example where this is advantageous. Let's just take all of it. And so we are sending phi and curve C to C composed with phi, and this is the right Lie group action. Okay, and then the shape space is defined to be. S, and we are just taking the quotient. I should write now P modulo diff S1. Ah, I think I still want to have the orientation preserving ones. So let me make a short remark here. Those are orientation preserving. Meaning that the phi dot of theta is greater than zero for all theta. The reason why I want this is, I think later when you, at least in the literature which I cite, I think what we are doing is we are disregarding the any absolute values we would have needed to take, which are cropping up in the formula. I don't think this is really a problem, but to stay consistent with the stuff I want to quote later on, let's take the orientation preservings, because then I know that the calculations which are going through there are all okay as they are written in the sources I'm citing later on. Okay, and due to the work by Michor and Mumford, we know that the equivariant L2 metric, let me just give it to you again. We saw this yesterday also. CFG, this is defined to be the infimum over phi. I don't want to take the infimum. So this is integral over S1 F composed with F of theta G of theta, and then I have to multiply with the norm C dot of theta D theta has vanishing geodesic distance. And when you look into the proof of Michor and Mumford, why has this vanishing geodesic distance? This is basically because this invariant metric is taking too little information about the functions which you're trying to compare. And they have some very nice graphical pictures, which I don't really want to go into now. I mean, their go-to example is you have two concentric circles which you want to relate to each other. And now they need to come up with a way of connecting them with shorter and shorter geodesic, or with shorter and shorter curves in the function space. So we think of the outer circle as our element C and the other one as D. So C and D are now living inside of our pre-shaped space and are infinite dimensional. And the picture is, I try to explain how you get these things. And basically what the idea is, so you see that your curve here, or the original curves, their tangent vectors is orthogonal to the radius of the circle, right? So, and you have that everywhere. And due to this inner product here, very roughly speaking, if you have something which moves orthogonally to the way the the outward shapes are moving. I mean, this is basically given by this one. Then you can get that the inner product gives you a zero when you evaluate it on things which are sitting orthogonally inside of R2. And the idea by or what Michaus and Mumford's ideas, and you can make this explicit and really computed, and their pictures are much better than me to explain what's going on. So what they are doing is they are hiding the distance they are going by going as long as possible orthogonally to these things. So the inner product which you have here, so you have this inner product, is the offender. Because you can basically speed up the curve in a direction which the inner product kills when you evaluate that. I want to be as vague here as I don't really want to go into the details, but this is the idea. So the defect of this equivariant metric is caused by this, because this metric is not measuring whether you are speeding up curves or so it's not incorporating any derivative information on your geodesic into the count here. And to remedy and this is the reason why, if you want to avoid this behavior, the L2 inner product is simply too simple to give you a sensible measure on this pre-shape space. On the shape space once you quotient out the diffeomorphisms. And the way out is to use inner products which are seeing derivative information, and we will define now an elastic inner product. So let's assume we have C in pre-shape space. Then we define several things. So first of all, we define UC of theta. This is the derivative of theta C, now normalized to length 1, right? So we are taking the unit vector here. And again, this makes sense because C is an immersion, so it doesn't get 0. So this is just normalizing. So this is the unit vector in the direction of the derivative. And then we can define the arc length derivative. And this is dc theta h. So this is h dot at theta divided by c dot at theta. And so recall that if I take the tangent space at the immersions, from S1 with values in R2. So this is our pre-shape space, right? So this pre-shape space is an open subset of the smooth functions from S1 with values in R2. And so therefore, the tangent space coincides with the tangent space of the smooth functions, or in other words, we can identify it as, again, as the smooth functions from S1 with values in R2. And we can thus define an inner product. On TCP. And okay, so we need a little bit of space to write down this inner product. So let me just start here. So this inner product is capital G, CHK. And of the h and the k, I think those are elements in the smooth functions from S1 with values in R2. Okay, and now let's define this. So I want to integrate over S1. So it's again one of these integral inner products. And now I take 1/4 of inner product, arc length derivative, c theta h, u c. I am suppressing the off theta things. I am multiplying this with the arc length derivative of k compared with UC. And now plus DC theta H minus UC multiplied with DC theta H UC. And I take this inner product. Oh, let's not write this here because I need the space. So the second contribution is plus dc theta h minus uc dc theta h uc, and then compared with dc theta k minus uc dc theta k uc. And then we have to close these things, and I'm still out of space for the d theta. Okay, and this gets the number 414. Let me just explain what this means. I mean, apart from the strange constant 1/4 in front here, so what this is, on first of all, we see that this every contribution we have here involves a derivative of the things we want to compare of h. So here are the derivatives of h. I mean, they are normalized to arc length. And here we have the derivatives with respect to k, again normalized. And what should you think of this? Recall what happens if you're taking an inner product of an element in a vector space with a norm one vector. Basically, we can think of this first contribution here as we are projecting the arc length derivative of h onto the unit vector uc. So this is basically measuring what is the derivative of h, now normalized with respect to the derivative of c, doing in the direction c is moving, right? So the uc was this guy upstairs here. So this was the uc. So this is just the direction the underlying curve c is pointing. And so the first contribution here measures in which sense is the h deforming stuff in the direction of c. So you can interpret this term as, the orange term, you can interpret this as, this is the stretching in the direction of the underlying curve. Whereas the second term here, gets multiplied by the stretching of with respect to now our second vector k, also in the direction of the derivative of the underlying curve. And so now when you look with this kind when you look at the second terms here, what is happening here? So this is actually now thinking back of Riemannian geometry, of Euclidean geometry. So we are basically subtracting from a vector a norm one vector times the projection, the orthogonal projection of the vector onto this norm one vector. So this is an orthogonal projection. Onto the orthogonal complement of this norm one vector. Right, so these two contributions which we are bracketing here, they are basically taking everything which wasn't accounted for by the first terms and evaluate them against each other. And the interpretation of this term here is stretching in direction of C dot, and the red stuff is just the opposite. So this is bending. This is all the deformation which is not happening in the direction of the underlying curve is going. So this is the interpretation of this thing is bending of the curve. Okay, and this is why this metric is called the this inner product is called an elastic inner product. And what you can prove is that due to its construction, if you run through all of this, I mean, basically you have to do a lengthy calculation looking at the inner products and at these derivatives. So this is the so-called elastic inner product. This is invariant under reparametrization with respect to gamma, right? Okay, so we get an invariant inner product, which is nice. All we have to understand now to get a nice geodesic distance is we have to understand how can we compute the geodesic distance. For the L2 metrics, this is very simple because we have explicit geodesics, we can compute them. For this one, it's probably challenging, right? If you look at the formula, if you had to figure out what are the geodesics for this guy, I mean, this is now an inner product, but we can continue this to a Riemannian metric. So actually this everything depends smoothly here on the base point C, and one can see that this gives rise to a smooth smooth Riemannian metric on the tangent space of the pre-shaped space. So we are not going there because now we are introducing this square root velocity transform, which allows us to transform, the reason why we define this metric is that the square root velocity transform transforms it to the L2 metric. And the L2 metric is simple to compute. So this is our interest in this metric. And actually, I mean, we are not really carrying out this calculation because it's technical. And again, you have to crawl through a lot of things here. But because of the squared velocity transform, which I will define in a moment, we have exactly these coefficients. So the 1/4 in front here, and the hidden one which stands in front of the second contribution. So this specific choice of constants here is used in identifying this the pullback metric of the L2 metric with respect to the squared velocity transform as exactly this elastic inner product here. This is where the constants are coming from. In principle, nobody is stopping you to write different constants in front of the two terms. So these elastic metrics, they form a whole family of metrics. However, if you want to go to the classical L2 metric, then the 1/4 and the 1 are the only choices you have if you want to go to the L2 metric, we understand. Okay, so let's do the definition. So we define two mappings, R from our pre-shaped space to all Q in the C infinity functions from S1 to R2. Such that Q of theta is never equal to zero for all theta in S1, or in other words, this is just those are the smooth functions from S1 which go to R2 without zero. Okay. Oh, this is not readable. Sorry. So go to R2 without zero. Okay. And the mapping is the one we already saw on the slides. So this is R, C, and if we evaluate this in a time parameter theta, this is by definition C dot theta divided by the square root of C dot theta. Okay, and then there's a mapping which is not by accident called the inverse. So C infinity S1 R2 without the zero goes to P, and Q goes to the integral over S1 Q multiplied with the norm of Q d theta, and now suppressing again the indices. So we call R the square root velocity transform, and okay, let's use the shorthand SRVT. Okay, so using that P is an open subset of the C infinity functions from S1 to R2, and our results on function spaces it is not hard to see. That R and R inverse are smooth. Moreover, we can of course plug them into each other. So what happens if I take R and then I take R inverse of some mapping Q, then by definition, this is R of the integral Q times norm Q dot d theta. And okay, so now we are taking the differential. So the integral goes out, so it's Q times the norm of Q dot divided by square root of the norm of Q times Q dot Q dot times what was I missing here? There's the norm, right? Okay, now everything works. So let's see. And okay, so what do we get here? Is this is of course the norm of Q times the norm of Q dot. Now I have the square root flying around. So where did I make a mistake here now? I think, okay, we want that this is actually Q here. Let's see. I'm missing a dot apparently somewhere. So I want the Q here. Okay, somewhere I made a mistake, but let's see. Somebody see the mistake? Okay, anyway, let's not dwell on this. So there's Okay, it will work out if I had two times this derivative there, and let's just quickly check. That. So where is the error here? Actually, there's a dot too much. This dot needs to go away. Now this is the inverse. Okay, good that we checked this. No dot here, no dot here, no dot here. Now it works. So we actually get Q, as should be, right? I apologize, there was one dot too much. So, okay. Now, so this is really the right, so R inverse is the right inverse to R. However, in general, we do not have the converse relation R inverse composed with R of C being equal to C. And why do we do not have that? Well, as you see, I already mentioned this. So taking the square root velocity transform involves a differentiation process. And afterwards we're integrating, but the integral cannot know where we have started. We get this only, or this relation only, for curves starting in C of, C of 1. So we always start, let our curves always start at 1, and where this is sent to 0. Okay, so we have to, so in other words, we have to restrict to the submanifold P star. And those are all the curves in P, such that C of cosine of 0, sine of 0, this is equal to 0. So this is, we are just controlling a function value here. And while I write the next result, you can think a moment about why is this P star actually a submanifold? How do we know that this is a submanifold? I mean, we have all this this nice results on function spaces, and you have taken the course. So if I would ask you, prove that the P star is a submanifold, how would you do it? Okay, and while we do that, let me just note the next thing. So one can show that the SRVT and its inverse induce a diffeomorphism between the P star and the C infinity functions from S1 with values in R2 without zero. Okay. Any ideas why the P star is a submanifold? I mean, a submanifold obviously of the P, and the P inherits its manifold structure from the C infinity functions from S1 with values in R2. So how would you go on about proving this? Well, the idea is quite simple. So we see that this P star is just the pre-image of the evaluation in cosine of 0, sine of 0, of 0. And we know that these evaluation mappings, so that was an earlier exercise, they are submersions on the C infinity function from S1 with values in R2. And if we restrict the submersion to an open subset in its domain, it stays a submersion. Okay. Okay, so this is basically just an application of this theorem on submersions. Okay, and let me now just, if you haven't seen it, let me give you the definition of a pullback metric. So let M G be a weak Riemannian metric. I shouldn't write Riemannian metric, I should write Riemannian manifold. And phi from N to M be an immersion. Then N can be made weak Riemannian manifold. With respect to the so-called pullback metric. And this pullback metric is usually defined by phi pullback G of M at points VW. This is defined as the metric at the image point, and then we take TM phi V TM phi W. And since our mapping phi is an immersion, you can prove that this definition gives you a Riemannian metric. And a particular example of this, which is also a very cheap example, so if U is an open subset of M, MG, a weak Riemannian manifold, then the inclusion is an immersion. And the restriction of G to the submanifold U is the pullback metric I need a iota pullback G. Right, so in particular, what we get here is that S1 R2 without the zero, this is an open subset, and we can look at the pullback L2 metric, which is just the restriction. So this becomes now a weak Riemannian manifold with respect to the restriction of the L2 metric. Okay, and now let me just state the result here, because this is a really, really annoying computation, which I don't want to show you, and actually I didn't want to give it to you as an exercise. Because there's a lot of things to do. So the pullback metric of the L2 metric on the C infinity functions from S1 values in R2 with respect to the square root velocity transform R is the elastic metric described by this 414 on each tangent space of the P star manifold. Okay. So why is this a nice result? Well, the L2 metric is computationally very simple. we have explicit geodesics, and so the idea is now study geodesics and properties of the L2 metric on C infinity S1 R2 without zero, and pull this back to P star. And since we know that the metric is invariant on under the action, we can also press it down to S star, which is just P star modulo the diffeomorphisms. Actually, I need to be a bit careful here, but okay, let's take the orientation preserving diffeomorphisms of S1. However, let me mention one caveat. So it's not, we studied, so what we have done so far, we have good control. Over the L2 metric on C infinity S1 R2. And then you look at it and say, well, this open set I am considering is almost everything of the C infinity function from S1 to R2. Right, so we have just thrown out a single point. How bad can it be? And the answer is, it's not really bad, but there are technical complications which are annoying, at least to people in application. So let me give you an impression of this. Let's again draw some pictures. So let's assume this is R2 without zero. So we have one point, so this is the zero point, and this point has to be avoided at all costs, right? Because it's not inside of our Riemannian manifold we are studying. And now we want to compute the geodesics and geodesic distances between shapes. Let's take, for example, these two things, and we know what the geodesics are. I'm always assuming that these things are parameterized in the same way, so let's not do anything more complicated. So I'm basically pulling all the points here over to each other, and so I get some sort of surface. Let's color this, so I get this surface here, which so I'm integrating over the surface, and this sort of the area of the surface. It's not entirely that, but basically we can think of what the L2 metric is computing as some sort of area measure for the deformation from one to the other. And everything is fine. So this is always positive. So we have nice geodesic distance. So the geodesic distance is always positive. You cannot have the strange behavior we saw for our counter examples where we had vanishing geodesic distance. So all of this is not happening here, which is very nice. However, what happens, let me just draw something like this here. So we have this ellipsis shape running around here. If the ellipsis is on this side of the zero, and then we have the same, okay, perhaps the same ellipsis on the other side of the zero. So the L2 metric doesn't know anything about this. So what the L2 metric is doing here is, well, okay, how do I map one of those things to the other? I mean, what would be the shortest distance? It's again, I need to connect, well, this point needs to be connected to that point, no problem. This point needs to be connected to that point. And well, we can basically play this little game a lot longer. So here we have to connect it to this one. All no problem. However, what the geodesics will try to do is say, for example, we have here a point which has y coordinate 0, then the corresponding point is on the other side of our forbidden point. However, what the geodesic with respect to the L2 will try to do is it will try to move this point through the zero point, through the forbidden point. And abstractly, for the mathematical theory, this is not allowed. I mean, why not? Remember, we wanted to compare stuff in shape space. Why is it so bad to just go through this one point? Can't we just allow this? And I mean, if we have a shape which, let's say, is going here, let me just draw something, and this is going through the forbidden point, why is this bad? So if we have this intermediate shape, let's call it this the CS shape, and if I'm plugging in the CS shape into my inverse transform, so this inverse transform is only defined on the smooth functions which take from S1 to R2 without this one point, and it goes to P star. What is P star? Those are immersions. And the formula is take the integral CS times norm of CS. Let's say it's S1 d theta. And what you see, what happens if we are running through this exceptional point, then we get a point. I mean, we can, of course, run this transformation, the R inverse. We can do this transformation, but we would then get a smooth map on the other side whose derivative vanishes at one point. And thus, it's not an immersion anymore, because immersions are smooth mappings whose derivative is not vanishing. So this is the reason why this red point is forbidden, because everything which takes a point, which takes an image on the red point, corresponds to a smooth map whose derivative vanishes at least at one point. And this is the forbidden point from the perspective of the immersion space. There have been some tries to remedy this by basically going away from smooth immersions to, and then you can define a square root velocity transform in a weakened setting. So you can work with absolutely continuous functions. Everything gets more complicated and you have to work more here. However, if you want to stay in the smooth world, you have to avoid this point, which is unfortunate, because when you're running numerical algorithms, for example, what you see, what the numerical algorithms will try to do, they are moving stuff through zero. So the numerical algorithms usually don't care that the intermediate points are sometimes zero. So they are basically moving through the forbidden point, and theoretically this is not satisfying, while for a lot of the applications in shape analysis, usually people ignore this. And you can even find, so I know at least one published paper which ignores this problem, where that you are not allowed to move through the point, and then draws some wrong conclusions from the negligence of this one point. So actually, I mean, the point here is, if you're working in this space, C infinity S1. R2 without the exceptional point. So you can ask yourself, and we put the GL2 metric on this. So the question you want to be asking is, what is the geodesic distance? And as long, so the distance, let me just label this. So what you really would like for theoretical and computational purposes, the geodesic distance in this space between two shapes C and D, this, it would be great if this was the same as the distance with respect to the L2 on the C infinity functions where you don't take out the point. So you just want to compute an L2 distance between these two functions. Right, And this is in general not true. This is only locally true, and locally means when your linear interpolation point-wise is not running through the forbidden point. Then this relation is only true if theta plus t theta plus 1 minus t d theta is not equal to 0 for all t from 0 to 1 and theta in S1. So if they are, so to speak, on the same side of the forbidden point and you are not running through this by your interpolation. And this is a theoretical challenge, especially when you want to generalize the square root velocity transform to other cases, where it works relatively decently is if you're, instead of going into a vector space, you can do a similar construction for Lie group valued data, and there it works relatively well. You can also have a similar construction for homogeneous spaces, so spaces on which you have a transitive Lie group action. And for these homogeneous spaces, it works a lot less well than you'd expect. And this is exactly because of problems you're getting here with this exceptional point. So the geometry thrust upon you by this exceptional point really creates some difficult problems, and surprisingly difficult if you're looking at the formula. And one way out of this, which at least personally, I think this is not very satisfying theoretically, is weakening the space. Do not use immersions. Go away from the smooth setting we've been working all the time in, and go to something like absolutely continuous functions, which are allowed to have an undefined derivative at certain points. Okay, and this ends our small excursion into the application of this L2 metric in the context of shape analysis.